My problem with the operaist and post-operaist view, because, you know, of course, position of Negri, but there are other people in the post-operaist school. For instance, I could have mentioned the work of Paolo Virno, which, you know, they all come from the Autonomia tradition in the 70s in Italy. And one of their main points, of course, was to put almost in exclusive emphasis on the one logic, which was the logic of worker resistance. For them, and I think their work was important in some aspect because they were criticizing some kind of deterministic Marxism, insisting that, you know, politics and worker struggle had played an important role in the transformation of capitalism, but they saw this process as exclusively driven by worker resistance to the process of exploitation, resistance which forced the capitalists to reorganize the process of production and to move to post-Fordism with its centrality of immaterial labor. So it is really a one-direction process. Well, this, of course, is an important element, but I think it's only part of the story. According to our approach, every order is the temporary and precarious articulation of contingent practices. This means that things could always have been otherwise, and that every order is predicated on the exclusion of other possibilities. It is always the expression of a particular structure of power relation. And, you know, it can always be transformed. So what Margaret Thatcher was saying, there is no alternative. There is always an alternative because every order, you know, is being predicated on the exclusion of other alternatives. And, for instance, the search for authenticity, the ideal of self-management, the anti-hierarchical exigency, all those demands of the counterculture have been used by capitalism to promote the condition required by the new mode of capitalist regulation. To be sure, Boltanski and Chapello never used this vocabulary, but I think that their analysis is a clear example of what Gramsci called hegemony through neutralization, or he sometimes used the term passive revolution, to refer to a situation where demands which challenges the hegemonic order are recuperated by the existing system. And the way they recuperate them is by satisfying those demands, but in a way that neutralizes their subversive potential. The political has a primary structuring role because social relations are ultimately contingent and any prevailing articulation result from an antagonistic confrontation whose outcome is never decided in advance. What is needed, therefore, is a strategy whose objective is through a set of counter-hegemonic interventions. One is going to disarticulate the existing hegemony and to establish a more progressive one thanks to a process of rearticulation of new and old elements in different configurations of power. But of course, this is something that can only be done from inside, not you know, from outside. The aim is to challenge relations of subordination in an increasing number of social relations. And this is what we have called a process of radicalization of democracy. Of course, this is why it is only as far as democratic difference are opposes to forces or discourses that negate all of them, that those differences can be substituted for each other. And this is precisely why the construction of a collective will of a people requires defining an adversary. And I want to insist that such an adversary cannot be defined in broad general terms like empire or capitalism for that matter. It must be defined in terms of nodal points of power that are going to be targeted and transformed in order to create the condition for a new hegemony. And this is what Gramsci called a war of position. A war of position that needs to be launched in a multiplicity of sites, right, to target different nodal points of power. And this war of position can only be done by establishing links between social movement, political parties, and trade unions. I mean, this, of course, is a point on which I strongly disagree with Hart and Negri when they say that, you know, but there should not be any work synergy between the multitude and the institution like parties, trade unions. For me, it's absolutely central to have this articulation, this synergy. To create through the construction of a chain of equivalence, a collective will to engage with a wide range of institutions with the aim of transforming them, this is, in my view, how radical politics should be envisaged. So I think it's clear now how it differs from the strategy put forward by Hart and Negri.